coming up on the April 8th edition of Sports Xtra. Clear eyes, full hearts, can't lose. The football team continues to push the pace as the Heels move toward the spring game.
And the softball team is in the zone and on a roll with another weekend sweep. We'll recap the weekend and look at one of the team's not-so-secret weapons.
The track and field team took its talents to South Beach. Well, almost. We'll go inside the Tar Heels' battle against tough competition and tougher weather. Sports Xtra starts
right now.
From the University of North Carolina School of Journalism and Mass Communication, covering the full range of Tar Heel athletics, this is Sports Xtra.
Hello and welcome to the April 8th edition of Sports Xtra, Carolina's only sports highlights, analysis, and issues show. I'm Madison Way.
And I'm Allie Massione. The sun is up, the weather is warm, the cleats are coming out. The Heels kicked off their second scrimmage Friday in Keenan Stadium. Head coach Larry Fedora said field conditions were unplayable at Grimsley High School, where the scrimmage was originally scheduled. One fan described the practice as an organized Chinese fire drill. As the Heels ran play, after play, after play, until the team completed 190 of them. Rising junior tight end Eric Ebron watched from the sidelines. No word as to why Ebron didn't participate.
But how will the team fare when it faces itself? The football team will hold its annual spring game this Saturday in Keenan Stadium. The team will begin signing autographs at 12:45 and kickoff is set for 3 p.m. And just in case we don't mention him enough here at Sports Xtra, Giovanni Bernard will be receiving an award during the first quarter for his impressive punt returning. Admission to all spring game activities is free. The men's basketball national championship is tonight, but UNC won't be taking the court. Michigan faces Louisville at 9:23. But a member of the Louisville Cardinals won't be on the court either.
The worst injury ever seen on a basketball court. That's how commentators for last week's game between Duke and Louisville described Louisville sophomore Kevin Ware's injury. Is it possible for Ware and players with a similar injury to come back and play basketball again? Julian Caldwell reports.
The fall that broke sophomore Louisville guard Kevin Ware's leg was so bad, we won't show it to you. All you have to see is teammates' reactions on the court, tears and all. But how bad is it?
Oh, he'll definitely be able to come back.
He won't be back for the national championship game tonight, but athletic trainer Megan Fulton predicts in about a year, he should be back on the hardwood.
He'll have a long road of rehab and, you know, some hard times ahead, but he'll definitely be able to come back and probably play basketball at the same high level, if not higher, you know, than he before the injury happened.
During surgery, a metal rod like this one was inserted into Ware's leg after resetting the bone. Fulton says massaging to keep down swelling will likely follow the surgery. Then it's on to rehab exercises to gain back agility and mobility. It's a process, but one Fulton says is successful for this type of injury.
When you break something, as he did, as horrific as it was, once it heals, you know, your bone heals and you tend to be just fine in the long run.
But sports psychologist Dr. Elizabeth Hedgepeth says the long run is the most trouble for recovering athletes. That's after teammates and other supporters pass the initial reaction to rally around the injured athlete.
They're not going to be gathering around him like they do. It's like any other tragedy. People come for a while and then they get on with their life.
Hedgepeth and Fulton both agree that maintaining confidence is the biggest challenge.
It's going to take time, and he won't know that he's going to be able to get through it until he gets through it.
And chances are he'll get through it before his college basketball career is over. In Chapel Hill, I'm Julian Caldwell.
Ware cheered on his team Saturday night in its win against Wichita State, and he should be in the house tonight to support his team in the fight for a national title. And national championships are something that Tar Heel Lenny Rosenbluth knows well. He's one of only 8 Carolina men's basketball players to have his jersey retired.
He was College Player of the Year and ACC Athlete of the Year in 1957. Rosenbluth is at most Carolina games cheering on the next generation of Tar Heel legends.
Rosenbluth led the Tar Heels to a national championship and a perfect season in 1957.
Our team, we were very good. And it got to the point where we just refused to lose.
That's the season that put North Carolina basketball on the map.
Back in the early 1950s, Carolina basketball was basically very low in the totem pole. When I got up to the varsity as my sophomore year, I think we were ranked like 230-something in the United States. And By my junior year, the next year, we were in the top 10 in the United States.
Only a year later, the Heels went undefeated and won the national title. After a few seasons in the NBA, followed by a long career as a high school history teacher and basketball coach in Florida, Rosenbluth has returned to Chapel Hill.
I've always loved Chapel Hill. I had a love affair with the university the first time I stepped on the campus in the summer of 1953. So that's almost 60 years ago.
Despite his many accomplishments, Rosenbluth says being a part of the Carolina family is what means the most to him.
It still gives me chills to be a member of the basketball family, knowing that our team basically got everything started.
We won the national championship, which is great. We were undefeated, which is also fabulous. But the most fabulous thing to me is when people ask me, did you go to college? And I said, yes. I went to the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, and I'm also a Tar Heel. And to me, that's the greatest thing.
And that is the Lenny Rosenbluth legacy. In Chapel Hill, I'm Lucy Buehrer.
Rosenbluth scored 895 points in the 1956-57 season and still holds the school record for most points scored in a season and highest single season per game average. We're lucky he's a part of the Carolina basketball family.
And another member of that family is in the Naismith Hall of Fame. Women's coach Sylvia Hatchell joins nine other Tar Heels to win the honor. Hatchell will be the first ever UNC female ever inducted into the Naismith Hall of Fame. She has the second most wins in women's basketball history. In February, she became just the third coach to eclipse the 900 win mark. Hatchell has three national championships to her name, including one here and one in her 27 years at Chapel Hill. And with the number one recruiting class in the nation coming next season, she could have another one in her future. The Naismith induction ceremony is in September.
On both Saturday and Sunday, the baseball team played its games from behind,
which is something junior third baseman Colin Moran says could help the team.
It's good for the team to kind of get some come-from-behind wins and low-scoring wins, and it'll be good for the young guys to get. You know, ACC baseball is not really too many blowouts. I know we've had some, but especially going down the stretch, we're going to play some real good teams, so it's good for the young guys to get that experience.
Going into the sixth inning Sunday, the Tar Heels were still down by two runs. Bases were loaded when Landon Lassiter stepped up to the plate and was hit by the pitch. The Tar Heels would score a run. Next up to bat, Moran was hit by another pitch. Zach Daly crossed home plate and the score was tied. In the eighth inning, Moran hit a homer to right field. This resulted in two more runs and would seal the fate for the Terps, and the Heels won the final game in the series.
Head coach Mike Fox, the top-ranked baseball team, joins us now live in the studio. So, coach, the team's ranked number one overall, but had to come back in two of the games against Maryland this weekend. So how would you assess how the team's playing so far this season?
So far, we played at a very high level. The question remains, can we continue to do that? We still have a lot of games left to play, and, you know, we could potentially be playing in June, and it's only April. So we like where we are at this point, and Colin's right, playing from behind is something that we're going to have to do probably, you know, in the future as well.
You know, like you said, you have several games coming up. You guys are about halfway through the season. What are you guys going to focus on for the remaining part of the season?
Well, the next 3 or 4 weeks, it's rest and the guys trying to keep their body, you know, going. And we play 15 games, I think, in the next 20 days. So the stretch is pretty tough until we get through final exam. So right now, it's just trying to play at a high level and let our guys get some rest and finish out their work academically as well as a lot of baseball games.
So let's talk about Ken Emanuel. He's been the ace for the pitching staff, but you've coached some pretty good pitchers in the recent past, Daniel Bard, Andrew Miller, Alex White. So how does Emanuel stack up against those guys?
Oh, I hate those questions, trying to compare players. But, you know, Kent's really, he's good. He's really good. I mean, there's no debating that. You know, how he compares with those guys, they're all different. You know, Kent's a strike thrower. He gives us a chance to win every Friday night. I think he's got a good future in this game beyond UNC, but right now we like having him as a Tar Heel for the next 8 or 10 starts.
And, you know, this season is the best start in UNC history. You've been to several College World Series. Do you think this year the Heels could take it all?
Well, we'll see. You know, it's one thing, you know, winning a regional and then a super regional and getting there. Once you get to Omaha, anything can happen. You know, I hope we're there at the end, and, you know, so far so good.
Baseball's coach Mike Fox, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Good luck the rest of the way.
Thank you.
Thanks.
One guy the coach will count on in coming weeks is Cody Stubbs. He's this week's ACC Player of the Week. In six games, he went 12 for 24 with one home run and 12 RBIs. He's on a seven-game hitting streak. Production like that will definitely get you to Omaha and the College World Series. Anchors away. No, Allie and I aren't going anywhere.
But members of one UNC club are. Next on Sports Xtra.
Connect with us online by liking the Sports Xtra Facebook page and following us on Twitter at SportsXtra_UNC.
Now it's time for This Week in Bad Stats.
Bad stats?
Horrible stats. Here goes. 132.
That's how many batters struck out four times in one game last season.
Wow, very good. Here's a tough one, though. 3-4.
No idea.
That's how many kids witnessed bullying. 3 out of 4.
That's not a good stat.
No, it's not, but it can change. Kids want to help, but they don't know how. Visit stopbullying.gov and give them the tools they need to help prevent bullying.
There are plenty of safe ways kids can help at stopbullying.gov.
Oh, those boys are much too much. Those boys are much too much. We got the spirit. We're hot. We can't be stopped. We got the spirit. We're hot. We can't be stopped. We're going to beat them and bust them. Beat them.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
Let's get a little bit rowdy. R-O-W-D-Y.
Take time to be a dad today.
All those boys are much too much. Those boys.
I've seen and been a part of many comebacks in my career.
To come back and win, you can't lose hope.
Take it one play at a time.
Grab every opportunity.
And when you can,
you make a big play.
There are over 13 million people in the Horn of Africa affected by famine, war, and drought that are counting on us for help.
As a team, we can help end this crisis.
Text GIVE to 777-444 to donate $10.
Let's start this comeback together.
Together.
My life is full of statistics. Thing is, I could have dropped out of school and become one myself, but I didn't because I had people that believed in me. Here's another statistic. 7,000 students drop out every school day. That's one every 26 seconds. It's time that students know that we believe in them.
Inspire a student and share your message of support at boostup.org.
It's spring and the weather is finally warm, which means it's the perfect time to sail the seven seas.
But Georgia Walker says if you prefer sailing catamarans and sunfishes to the Black Pearl, and you'd rather stick with Jordan Lake, then the UNC Sailing Club is the place for you.
You don't have to travel to the beach to go sailing. The UNC Sailing Club has 4 sailboats on Jordan Lake available to members at their leisure. One club member, Daniel Safferstein, is new to the club and is just learning to sail.
The environment, actually, it's kind of the people. It's just getting out into the water. I really enjoy.
The captain of the racing sailing team, Elizabeth Whitener, says sailing is a sport unlike any other.
Well, it's different. It's not like, you know, running or like playing tennis or something. Like, it's something that not a lot of people do, and it's definitely a skill that involves a ton of different things.
The president of the sailing club, Brent Hoffman, holds on-land sailing lessons to teach the logistics of wind patterns. With a limited number of boats, he says the smaller the sailing club is, the better.
Like seeing how hard it was to manage the club a few years ago when we did have such a large roster, I think it'd be best just to keep the club kind of capped at where it is. We're not going to turn people away, obviously.
Think you're ready to become a sailor? At UNC's port at Jordan Lake, I'm going to show you the most important parts of the boat. This is the mainsail. So this bar is the boom. Can you guess why it's called the boom? Yeah, because that's the sound it makes when it hits your head when it's flying across the boat. So this is the tiller, the most important part of the boat, because this is what steers the boat, and it's connected to the rudder.
I might not be joining the sailing team anytime soon, but the relaxing view at Jordan Lake is enough to attract sailors of all levels. From Jordan Lake, I'm Georgia Walker.
Students interested in joining the sailing club can contact any member for more information.
Some members of the track and field team took their talents to South Beach this weekend, or at least partway there. The Heels made the long trip to the University of Florida for the annual Florida Relays. The Heels did their best to start the weekend with a bang, but the surprisingly chilly Gainesville weather put a damper on many of Friday's events. RJ Alawanle showed his Minnesota roots and shook off the cold, earning fourth among collegiate runners in the 400-meter hurdles. Jacinda Evans tied for the longest jump of the weekend, launching herself farther than 20 and a half feet. Evans says she's pleased with the way Carolina handled the climate curveball.
I thought I would jump way farther, but considering like the wind and the rain and how cold it was, I think I did well. And I think my teammates did well too.
And the team performed even better as the sun shined bright on Saturday. A couple of freshman throwers carried the Heels on day two of the relays. Sarah Howard finished sixth in the women's shot, and Dontravius Owsley took second in the men's discus, both setting personal records. The Heels hope to carry their momentum and some warmer weather into the Joe Hilton Invitational at home next weekend.
It's a tale of two streaks for the women's and men's lacrosse teams. The Maryland Terrapins snapped the women's lacrosse team's 11-game winning streak Saturday. The Terps edged the Heels 14-13, but North Carolina will be back on Fetzer Field Friday at 7 for senior night against Jacksonville. But the men's lacrosse team is on a 5-game winning streak. The Tar Heels took down the Virginia Cavaliers Saturday in Charlottesville 10-7. The team was led by freshman goalkeeper Kieran Burke, who made 23 saves off of 51 UVA shots. And that leads us to this week's hidden stat. Burke's 23 saves are his career high and the most by a UNC goalkeeper since 2003. Paul Spellman had 25 saves in a 10-6 win against Maryland that season. Burke also has the fourth highest total saves by a Division I goalkeeper this season. Pretty impressive for just a freshman.
The Heels continue to command the Cavaliers as the softball team swept UVA this weekend, improving to 9-3 in the ACC. The Cavs struck first in both of Saturday's games, but the Heels kept their composure and came back. The 2-1 victory on Sunday was a much more defensive win as the team allowed only two hits. Coach Donna Papa felt that both coming from behind and winning tight games was a good experience for the Heels.
You know, I think it helps your team in a lot of ways. Certainly you want to score more runs and have a little more breathing room, but I think we've shown that we can hold a lead, a one-run lead, and that's going to help us down the road too.
With the win, Lori Spangola improves to a 21-10 on the season.
The team will be back in action on Wednesday at home versus Elon.
No secret that junior Lori Spangola's pitching is a major contribution to the Tar Heel success. This week, she's our player of the week after recording her 200th strikeout of the season. That's not surprising, though, because last season, Spangola had 333 strikeouts and was named the ACC Pitcher of the Year. Lori is with Sports Extra's Catherine Fitzgerald in the Reese Feltz Digital Newsroom.
Spangola is definitely the ace of the staff, and we're really excited to have her here. So, Lori, between the three games this weekend, you pitched 17 innings. How do you stay physically and mentally focused for that?
Really just going after each hitter, you know, one pitch at a time and really staying competitive and, you know, attacking each hitter and not really thinking more about the physical, like, you know, soreness and stuff like that, just trying to stay mentally tough.
Okay, great. So Sunday you had 5 strikeouts, reached your 200 Ks for the season, and you got the win. Do you focus more on each at bat or kind of the big picture of just going away with the win?
Yeah, just kind of focusing each at bat, just like, you know, as I said, one pitch at a time and, you know, going after the hitters with the scouting report. We, you know, scout each hitter before the game and just going with the plan, and that really seemed to work.
Okay. And then you have Elon up next on Wednesday. What's the team focusing on for this game?
Just like any other team, just going at them, and you know, midweek games are big for us. You know, we have to put those teams away just like we do our series games. So, you know, going after Elon just like anyone else.
Awesome. Well, good luck against Elon. Thank you so much for joining us. And Madison, back to you.
That was Lori Spangola and Sports Extra's Catherine Fitzgerald live in the Reese Feltz Digital Newsroom. Undefeated on the number one team in the nation.
I guess that makes this Heel the best of the best. We'll meet a Tar Heel on top next on Sports Extra.
Thank you for calling your GED Pep Talk Center. All right, now, are you ready for your GED Pep Talk? Being nervous is okay. It just shows that you're serious about getting your diploma.
A lot of things are scary. Heck, I'm scared of clowns.
No quiero oír. Danny, no lo puedo hacer.
DMC, life in your pep talk style.
Just keeping it real, Deb, just keeping it real.
Whatever motivation you need, we've got a pep talk for you. Get your GED pep talk and find free classes at yourged.org.
G morning, sunshine. Wakey, wakey. Text me. I think it might be one of the morning. Are your parents home later? We can hang. LUV, love you. JK. Holla back. Holla back. Holla back.
Are you with your friends?
That's lame. We're in a huge fight right now. XO.
What'd you dream about?
Something I did. Are you on your way to the mall? Only. Nude pics. Send me some. Text me.
All right, give me a spot. You know my motto, safety first.
They could be dangerous. I think we should call animal control.
Animal control?
To be safe.
Don't worry. Just... I got this. It's a new motto.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you.
You didn't give up on sex. Don't give up on birth control either. There are more methods than you think. Find yours at bedsider.org.
After losing against UVA last week, Coach Brian Calvis and the women's tennis team got back on the victory trail this weekend. The ladies swept Georgia Tech.
We told them we have to learn and forget. We had to learn from the loss, and we had to forget about the loss, and I think we did a really good job yesterday doing that.
The ladies swept Georgia Tech Friday and beat Clemson 4-3 Saturday afternoon. They won the doubles point against the Tigers and got singles matches wins from Caroline Price, Lauren McHale, and Gina Suarez-Malgudi. The top-seeded Tar Heel looks forward to the tough week coming up for the team, traveling to number 10 Miami and Florida State.
Miami has always been a big, huge competitor against us. And so, we lost to them last year in NCAAs. And so I'm very, very excited. I cannot wait to play them and just give everything out there.
Wins against Miami and Florida State would put the top-seeded Tar Heels record at 12-2 and their ACC record at 6-1. 18 wins, 0 losses. That's the impressive record of sophomore Caroline Price.
She's the only undefeated Tar Heel on the women's tennis team this season. Tia Monval met her for Sports Extra.
Even though she finished with the best record on the team in singles matches her first year, Caroline Price was an unsteady player, and Coach Brian Kolbas expected more.
Last year, she struggled a little bit, okay? And I thought that she was capable of having a better freshman year. So I think she had a kind of a sense of urgency to kind of, you know, take her freshman year and learn from it and get a lot better.
And she did. Caroline is undefeated in singles matches this season, and she's lost only one set. This impressive streak has her ranked 33rd in the nation, a position that could open the doors to the NCAA tournament. That would be unusual, given her ranking on the Carolina team.
Normally, the 4 or 5 player on the team does not get into the tournament individually at the end of the year. So my goal is to continue to win all my matches to give me the opportunity to get into that tournament, and then I want to win it.
And according to Coach Brian Kolbas, she has the potential to make it to the tournament.
I think she can. I mean, if she stays focused and, you know, takes it one match at a time, I think she's done a really good job. She's had a lot of good wins this year, so I think she's definitely in a good position to accomplish that goal.
Caroline is only a sophomore, but she's ready to take on more responsibilities.
Coach already said this year that he wanted me to step up, be a leader, so I've been really trying on the court, but next year I feel like I can be a leader on and off the court a lot more.
If she keeps winning all her singles matches, it might be hard to improve her leadership on the court. But if we believe what we see here, she might need to get a little bit better at cheering. In Chapel Hill, I'm Teo Manval.
The men's tennis team isn't as consistent as Caroline Price. It was a weekend of ups and downs as UNC ended an 8-game losing streak Friday with a 5-2 victory against Georgia Tech. The team took the doubles point in 4 of the 6 singles matches, earning the team's first win since February 24th. But the Heels couldn't continue their winning way Sunday, losing to Clemson 6-1. Carolina will look to win its second conference game Friday when the team faces Miami at home. There's one Tar Heel who's an All-American who you probably don't know in a sport you probably don't understand.
Stick with us and we'll take a stab at it.
Don't forget to tune in to our sister shows, Carolina Week at 5 p.m. every Wednesday on Time Warner 24 or Campus Channel 34, and Carolina Connection at 8:30 every Saturday morning on WCHL 97.9 FM.
Packers,
Vikings,
Red State, Blue State.
We come from different places.
Uptown.
But when we live united, we create real lasting change in the education, income, and health of our country. Real change won't happen without you. So give, advocate, volunteer, live united. Sign up at liveunited.org.
Body language can tell you all sorts of things. Like someone is having a stroke. Know the sudden signs. Learn fast. Face drooping, arm weakness, speech difficulty. Time to call 911 and get them to a hospital immediately. Learn the body language and spot a stroke fast.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call or visit fatherhood.gov to learn more.
Foods to the right temperature using a food thermometer. 3,000 Americans will die from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
Tar Heels bleed Carolina blue for UNC teams.
But there's one varsity sport some fans might have overlooked. Janelle Davis scouts UNC fencing.
Heels have never heard of Julian Lutinski. She's an All-American fencer and plays third in this year's NCAA Sabre Championships.
Definitely my mental game was stronger this year because I let go of the losses and was like, okay, that one happened, but this is the next one. I need this one now.
What makes fencing the ultimate sport?
To focus on tactically beating your opponent, thinking, what am I going to do next?
It's kind of like playing chess at the speed of boxing.
You have to be able to make split-second decisions over and over and over.
So one of our reporters took a stab at the ultimate sport.
Today we'll be fencing at bay, and where the whole body is the target, and we'll be playing to 5 points. Great job, but I think she has a ways to go before she can keep up with UNC fencing.
It'd be hard for most rookies to keep up with these heels. They finished 11th overall this year, which is their highest finish in more than a decade. In Chapel Hill, I'm Janelle Davis.
Lutinski's third place finish is fencing's best finish since 2000, and I should probably never pursue a career in fencing.
Madison, I hate to say it, but you're probably right.
It is a lot harder than it looks.
Yeah, I'm sure it is.
And wait, can I set the record straight? I got 3 points. They only showed one, but I scored 3 times against the UNC.
It was a nice soundtrack. I liked the Eye of the Tiger. That was kind of inspirational.
Well, they weren't playing that either. I just got myself hyped up on my own. And also, the coach told me that I had good footwork, so.
You were rocking the uniform, too, you know. It's like a Parent Trap throwback that brought me back to that scene.
Yeah, that's also really difficult to put on. Everything was a lot harder than I thought it was going to be.
Well, on that note, that does it for this edition of Sports Xtra.
Thanks for watching. Good night.